that.
Roy, why did you turn to the Lithgow Bank?
Oh, Hartmann Paul, look, I've always been taken, you know, right from the outset with their advertising. It's always been very, 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 very subtle. The first time I saw a simple but substantial and very, very, very elegant bed flute wrapped in a $100 bill, well, it caught my eye, and I said to myself, there and then, here's a bank that talks my language. And once my interest was aroused, they turned out to be, well, tremendous people, Paul, with tremendous ideas.
The Lithgow Bank, where the back door is always open.
Two triple.
On the final episode of Roy and HG's True History of Communism in Australia, the Russian domination of the Australian automotive industry.
Australia wanted a car. We cooked up the Holden. All models were communist-coded. The 1948 FX indicated the fall of China to Mao's troops. 1956 FJ precursed by days the collapse of the Hungarian uprising. And the 68 HD spelled the death knell for the Prague Spring. The 179 motor was the prototype for the engine that took Yuri Gagarin into space. The Torana chassis became the undercarriage of the MiG-17. The Monaro, the only car that went better backwards than forwards, was the foundation of the Soyuz space capsule. Fisherman's Bend guaranteed Soviet supremacy in space for three decades.
As Peter Brock observed at Bathurst, Holden Advertising always claimed they were built for Australian conditions, but I never thought they were designed for anything but flight. I always wanted to drop one out of a plane to see what would happen. The RAAF never gave me a Hercules to try it. I maintain the whole GMH badge were grounded birds. Roy and HG's True History of Communism in Australia, coming soon.
In news that I'm very proud as an Australian to announce this afternoon, Jimmy Thunder, Australia's Jimmy Thunder, last night became Australia's IBF, International Boxing Federation, World Heavyweight Champion. Jimmy Thunder, I think, and I could stand corrected here, is Australia's first heavyweight champion. Jimmy Thunder, HG and myself have our hats off, our trousers off, and I know all Australians, as I speak now, would be standing and just giving a couple of moments' silence to Jimmy Thunder. Do so now. Stand. If you're in a car, pull over and just stand outside your car now. Jimmy, congratulations. Federation Cup team. I spoke with him immediately afterwards. I spoke with the Rabbit Turnbull. I said, Wendy, Greg's won. Michael Doohan has won, broken leg notwithstanding. Australia's in a winning position at the moment, you know, with Fraser, with the Super Woodies, we've won the Davis Cup. Try and harness that with Nicole Provost and with your players, and I think you might find yourself coming strong. They couldn't believe that the Shark had won, and I think it was the Shark's victory, whatever force it was, whatever special magic occurred, whatever special thing that the Shark was imbued with or by for that marvellous 4 days, that magic zephyr, that magic spirit, spirited itself over to all those other Australians. That's what I love about being Australian, that we help each other. Sure, you can call it mateship. Sure, you can call it the spirit of Anzac. Call it whatever you like. I call it the winning spirit. I've likened it in days gone by to a virus. All you got to do is catch it.
Girls, you've loved their work on the paddock, but you can't get them to come across after the full-time siren sounds. Why not spend a three-night intensive with Roy and HG and guest lecturers Noel and Les Cleal and learn how the sports stars like it? This course is not available at TAFEs or universities and is simply called Crack On to a Cricketer. Learn what to say and when to say it. Learn what faces to pull when it comes to your turn to talk and what to do with your lips while they rabbit on and on about past digs. Graduates from this course in previous years are now happily married to Merv Hughes, Stumpy Boone, Terry Alderman and David Hooks. And we are pleased to announce the engagement of Shane Warne to one of our most recent graduates. Just look in the local paper for details.
I'm just wondering whether we might be able to start with the Olympic Challenge Four Corners last Monday night. Didn't it reveal, for you know, so convincingly, why we have been saying now for the best part of 3 years that the Sydney 2000 Games are coming to Sydney. Should I say, you know, obviously indicated that in the phrase there, but the Olympic Games of the year 2000 are coming into Sydney. It was just tremendous to see people so impressed with Australian hospitality that they couldn't remember how many times they'd eaten with the Australians. They couldn't remember how often, how much the lobster had cost.
Yes.
When they could never remember paying for it. And wasn't that fantastic to see mein Führer, Juan Antonio Samaranch, sitting there with the Australians clustered around him?
Yes.
Firstly, they excused the camera. Mm. Gough didn't say a word. No. The fact that Gough was sitting there, Stumm, as I said in my opening comments, I think said an enormous amount.
Yes.
Because let's face it, Juan and Gough have never got it on. They've never seen eye to eye about anything.
Philosophically.
No. But when it comes, that's the great thing about the Olympic movement, that you will accept somebody being called Il Presidente when he's not actually the head of anything except, a tin pot group of 106 people who are appointed for life on the basis they once did something.
Yes.
And Snouts in the Trough, I thought it was a terrific program, and I thought it was very, very convincing.
Yes, I think it's not as easy as it might seem, HG, to become an IOC delegate. My understanding is you have to, for a start, be able to sit down with Juan Antonio and two other delegates and be able to drink 8 bottles of champagne, to eat 2 pigs fully basted in front of you, to be able to then have a few eggs, plover's eggs, naturally enough. Then you have to imbibe, or take on board, I should say, I think it's 4,500 stuffed lark's tongues, and then be able to cut it on the dance floor and to be able to nod appropriately when someone comes up to you, obviously it'd be a stooge in the trial, and says, "Did you get the ball I sent you?"
In French, if you speak English.
Yes, yes. And so you've just got to go, "Oh, what? Sorry. Did you get the ball I sent you? Sorry? What? Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, thanks. It was great." And then move on. These skills, I mean, they're not easy.
No.
You know, it's not easy. And be able to back up the next day.
Do the same thing again.
For the same.
Yeah. That's the thing that impressed me most, was how much you have to put away. Mm. How much people are prepared to, you know, shovel down your throat just to get your vote.
Yes.
I mean, that's the thing. That's where you need your stamina. That's where you need your size. That's where you need your commitment to the IOC thing. Because people must look at it with trepidation.
Mm.
You know, all that free stuff. I mean, where are you going to put it all? And remembering it all.
Yeah.
I mean, remembering it all, that he did actually get the soccer ball.
Yeah. Well, I don't think it matters whether you can remember or not. You know, I don't.
It's the performance.
It's the performance.
Yes, of looking as though you can...
Yes!
You can locate it.
That's right.
In the upstairs attic,
exactly.
Even though there's nothing there.
No, that's right. Try me. You know, imagine you've given me the soccer ball.
Roy, you've heard of Sydney's bid.
Mm.
Did you get that... That inflamed cheese flute I sent you in the Sydney colours? I've spoken very slowly because I understand you only speak Italian. Coming from Italy, as of course you would, you know, and I so delicate. Did you get, and then of course because I'm embarrassed, I shout louder, Roy, did you get the inflamed cheese flute I sent you as part of the Sydney 2000 big package? Roy, are you deaf? You know, I don't think he understands English anymore.
Then I'd pause for a little bit longer and then look, hopefully there'd be an interpreter standing there who'd relay this to me and say, you know, excuse me...
Monsignor.
Yes.
Slaven.
Yes, Monsignor Slaven or whatever. Excuse
Love
me.
Love the frock.
Excellency. Excellency, what our loud friend is saying is...
Our Australian friend.
Yes, what our loud Australian friend is saying is, did you receive a rather gauche bit of... frippery through the mail, and I would then say, well, see,
good.
That's how it works. I'm pretty sure that's how it works.
Yeah, no, I take your point.
But don't tell me that's easy. It is not.
Sorry,
who has the harder job there?
Yeah, the person giving or the person receiving?
Yes,
obviously, the person receiving.
Receiving, obviously.
Yeah.
Obviously,
Roy, what else?
It'd be too easy to say, yes, I did get it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What did he say?
That's right. No, you've got to do it the other way around.
Do it the other way.
You've got to stand there, stumm, until the interpreter translates what's the poor, you know, the Australian, on this case, Roddy McGeoch's bleeding on about.
Yeah.
Then you play out dumb show style, thinking about it, locating it in your mind, the mythical object, and then an effusive response.
Sure. And, you know, you rely terribly much on your interpreter, too. I mean, I've been in circumstances like that where someone has come up to me, might have been, you know, speaking a language with which I'm unfamiliar, Dutch, for example. And has said, you know, did you receive the tickets to, say, Phantom of the Opera? And the interpreter has said to me, Roy, do you want this gentleman to wipe your bottom? To which I've said, Yes, please.
Yes.
But well, can you wait a minute?
Yeah,
till I'm ready.
Yeah, done the carpet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's very difficult to translate.
It causes all sorts of confusion.
When it goes back into the Dutch.
Well, indeed, because, you know, superficially, there are enormous similarities between having a brown date wiped and a night at Phantom of the Opera.
But, Roy, what's difficult is when you say, you know, I haven't finished with the carpet yet, and then you get people looking at the floor, you know, wondering whether they should wipe that first. You know, I mean, that's where the trouble comes, is when you go back into the other language.
Yes, yes, that's exactly right.
You know, Roy, what else was going on?
Well, both arguably can be music of the night, can't they?
They can. And both be as interestingly, sort of what was I going to say, as fulfilling experiences.
Oh, yes.
You know, both being very, very satisfying.
Well, they're both out of body.
Yes. Now, Roy, at that Four Corners do that we were lucky enough to be at when they filmed, you know, obviously working the room just out of camera where we like to work, what else was going on? I think we should reveal certain things that were going on in the edges of frame, which, fortunately, I must say, for the Sydney bid, were left out of that report. I mean...
Well, there's obviously a lot of wiping.
And to see Bruce Baird dolled up...
Bruce Baird,
Yes, indeed, Baird, after he'd been dolled up so attractively, I think it was a highlight. And I know Wayne Antonio took me aside and said afterwards, you know, is that man Australian? And I said, he certainly, most certainly is, but he comes from a part of Australia I don't recognise, Wayne, mein Führer. Yeah. And he understood what I was saying.
Yes.
He understood because he had no idea that Australians could behave like that.
No, I know.
I mean, he had seen film, obviously, which came out at the time of the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Mardi Gras and was used to people talking off, but seeing, you know, substantially big names about town, you know, he's very, very impressed.
Look, I was impressed. I was impressed with the, you know, the everyone pointing in the same direction with the Sydney bit of all the Australian delegates. You know, when Juan decided it would be entertaining to show some film footage of people being shot, essentially, in Spain during Franco's time, while at the same, this black and white footage, very hauntingly sepia footage, on the going on, you know, across the room, with Juan giggling as he does when he looks at this sort of thing, and to have a lot of the delegates, you know, covered in pig fat, rolling around on the floor with flutes akimbo and flutes of champagne going in one end, and bits of gear coming out the other, and pies being hurled about, and gold jewellery, you know, being thrown at the ceiling to see if it would stick, and that sort of thing. When that was going on, I thought it was, I thought Gough was magnificent, just sitting there passively observing it at all, peeling a grape, and every now and again
putting in Juan's bot.
Yeah, that's right, and only occasionally lifting his toga when. You know,
Juan pressed him.
Yeah. look, I just wish Four Corners had got more of that sort of footage.
Yeah, so do I. But I take my hat off to Four Corners because obviously the
they didn't want to cop to the kibosh.
Well, that's it, indeed. Mm. What happened was, of course, obviously Bruce Baird and John Fay knew all this was likely to have been filmed.
Mm.
And so they came back to Australia and obviously put the word about that the ABC's funding would be cut if any of that sort of stuff that we've just described got to air.
Yeah.
And I take my hat off to Four Corners.
Well,
they charted a very pleasant course through it all.
Yes.
They made it look as though everything was appropriate.
Yes.
They made it look as though everybody did get their soccer ball.
Mm.
They made it look as though everybody did play due deference to mein Führer, you know, and so on. And I think that they've done a very, very good job.
Yes.
And I know that Wayne was very impressed that none of the school stuff...
Was censored so well. The school stuff wasn't there, nor was pouring the ice cubes down Gough's underpants. That wasn't there.
That was funny, though, wasn't it?
Oh, very, very funny. I mean, he's got a sort of cheeky sense of humour, hasn't he? It's very...
Cheeky, yes.
Spanish.
Yes.
It's the sort of humour that is only derived really from a culture that gets an enormous amount of fun from killing bulls slowly.
Olympic bids, and while the US Senate bags the Chinese bid, Manchester looms up on the outside of the front-running Sydney as a rival as we run up to the judge on September 23rd, 24th. Now, last week, my very dear friends, I had official estimates that we were all going to be about 7.3 billion better off at the end of the Big O go round in the year 2000 than we were beforehand. I gave the figuring a bit of a geek after I came off air and thought the figures were on the little rubbery, or certainly a little rubbery, on the low side. I saw the possibilities of at least $17.3 billion being left in the kick when the final hooter blew in the year 2000. Now, if certain cost-cutting measures were introduced, this would mean at least $1,000 payout to everybody directly into their kick from the IOC, which can't be bad. But these figures, these substantially correct figures, I believe, were shot down in flames on Monday by doubting Thomas's and Thomasina's in the Financial Caper. The story ran that sadly there was no comparable events to make accurate comparisons with vis-a-vis cash in hand at the end of the day. So numbers could be on the high side or the low side. Inflation, lack of TV interest could eat into the figures, dot, 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 fill in the rest yourself. But ladies and gentlemen, I ask you here today on The Life, what price would you put on seeing a fit young Asian Australian kiddie, say from Caboolture, bagging gold at Homebush by the length of the pool in the 1500 metres against the world best, smashing the world record by 2.3 seconds? What price, ladies and gentlemen? Come on, be fair. What price? Ladies and gentlemen, I put it to you that it would not matter how much it cost. It would not matter how much debt we got into. It would not matter if the bills were never paid. Because, ladies and gentlemen, that is the magnificent raw beauty of this Olympic movement. Seeing fit young Australian Asians going for gold here at home in their own backyard. It's magic that lives with one forever and is quite simply priceless. And when your grandkiddies ask, as they will in years to come, simple stumpers like, what were the Olympic Games like, Grandad, Grandma? You'll be able to say to little Theo, I was there when that Caboolture kiddie, whose name escapes me still, went in for the big splash and bagged gold in the 1500 metres. Ladies and gentlemen, look, I've got a bit of a confession to make. I even though I've covered hundreds of top meets, Olympic Games and world contests of all sorts personally, I've never seen a young, fit Australian win gold. The only gold I have ever witnessed with my own eyes was the gold dished out in a cheddar cheese competition in the 1967 Adelaide show. When the results were announced, well, I had goosebumps all over me and had to go outside for a settling Woody Woodruff's lemonade in the screw top and a violet crumble bar out of my Hoadley show bag. So I can only imagine what a sporting gold medal would be like. Witness, it must be a memory that stays with you for a lifetime. And even if it does, ladies and gentlemen, as I say, cost us each $7.3 billion, surely that is a very small price to pay. And ultimately, isn't that the line and length of Juan Antonio's message to us all? Ladies and gentlemen, Juan speak. You can't simply spend enough money on the IOC or me personally. That's what
I've been like blaming the messenger for the message, I must say. I've never been party to that sort of thing. But I think in this instance, the media is largely responsible for what gets filtered through. See, in my day, it was a little bit different because the dressing rooms were out of bounds. And you could get up to your harmless hijinks, your euphoric post-victory hijinks, very much to yourself. We were in camera. And we knew that. We knew. You took it as read that no matter what happened in the dressing room, when the trousers came off and blokes fiddled with themselves and that sort of thing, when that went on, you knew you could do it with the comfort of knowing that even if somebody did see it, someone with a camera, they wouldn't use it. And if they did take a picture, it would only be for their private use and it would never be given, you know, access to the public. Now, I think players should be able to express themselves. I'm mindful of, say, at the end of a Grand Prix, where, say, you've got Nigel Mansell in the heady days of 1991, I think he was world champion. At the end of a Grand Prix, he's given a magnum of champagne, he shakes it up, and it literally ejaculates over the crowd. And that symbolism, I don't think, is accidental. It's very maleist, it's very fertile, it's symbolising virility. And I think, you know, if a winner cannot shake up his magnum of champagne and priapsis-like ejaculate symbolically over a crowd of, excitable young kiddies, then I think the game's come to a very sorry state. Ditto with the Australian dressing rooms, with the euphoria of Merv and Booney shaking up beers and releasing their contents so that they spew forth cascade ejaculatory style over everyone, then I think it's a very sorry state again when players can't celebrate this rite of passage, this rite of winner's passage, of expressing themselves physically in symbolic form. I think that's much healthier than actually taking the trouser off. And going to town.
Yes, I know. Well, Stumpy and Merv, it's just distant memories for them, taking the trousers off and going to town. But I say this is, remember when Canberra first won the premiership flag and the quit for life?
Oh, Laurie Daly.
Yeah, they were so poor they couldn't afford a magnum of champagne, so they'd get Laurie to do the job for them, in the trouser department, obviously in an attempt to save costs.
He was the magnum of champagne,
indeed the magnum of champagne in the heady days there. Mm. And
Shook himself up.
And then, all over the teammates.
Yes.
Roy, I take your point.
But that didn't get to air.
No, I agree.
You see what I mean? It'd be different if that had gone public. If the Channel 10 or Channel 9 or Channel 7 news people who had that footage, and it was, the footage, the cameras were there because the Prime Minister was there, the then Prime Minister Bob Hawke, who went through to celebrate with the, I think there might have been,
Raiders.
Were they Woodgers then? Or
I
were
think
they
might have been Woodgers Raiders. No, Video Easy the next year.
Oh, well, they might have been Jim Woodgers. Yes. They might have been Woodgers Raiders in that time with their first victory. And the Prime Minister went in to congratulate them, and there was Laurie on the table, pleasuring himself.
Shaking the Magnum.
Shaking the Magnum. Because of a bet he'd had with Gary Coyne, from memory. I think that was it. And the Prime Minister had to endure this and have his suit dry clean once
with
he left.
With the little maps of Africa all over it.
Sure, sure. Now, I didn't think there was anything wrong with that at all. I thought that was fine, because it didn't go to air.
Yes. Well, I take your point...
Had it gone to air?
Yeah.
Well, you'd have to blame the medium.
Well, I take your point entirely, and I believe that this wouldn't go on unless certain alcohol makers were involved in the sponsorship of these games.
Yes, of course.
Obviously, if you're a home builder, you don't feel as though you don't mind seeing a player shaking up the Magnum and obviously going to spray all over the Prime Minister.
No.
But, on the other hand, if you're an alcohol maker, what you want to get and plant in the audience's mind at home watching the 7 o'clock news is spraying a can of, sponsor's product. Mm. It's a lot more entertaining and fulfilling than getting on the job.
Yes. Yeah, I'd agree with you. Well, it wouldn't have been the same had Laurie Daly sort of banged in a few clouts as a result of the victory. I mean, it wouldn't have worked. I mean, you do need the Magnum, whatever form it might take. And then here's a bank that talks my language. And once my interest was aroused, they turned out to be, well, tremendous people, Paul, with tremendous ideas.
The Lithgow Bank, where the back door is always open.
Too true, Paul.
Well, we spoke to Johnny Valder, who's organising this, and, gee, if you've been to a Johnny Valder party...
Oh, Liberal Party style.
They're tremendous. Oh, after hours.
Yes.
It's very funny. It's
all date and finger food, isn't it?
It is indeed, and it never runs out.
Mm.
Everything's golden brown. It's just beautiful to look at. You can't imagine that there's so many different shades of brown.
Mm.
But when Johnny Valder goes to work, it's just tremendous. He says that, obviously... Win or lose, the party will continue till 9 a.m. to thank Sydney for all its and all of Asia for its support in the bid. Mm. We want people to go to work, obviously, after the big do. Obviously, they'll be pretty legless, but that'll be just the ticket for a good day at work. Plenty of hotels and clubs and so on are having all-night parties and special dinners and so on. Mm. And there will be filling up the home Bush Bay area.
With beer.
With beer, and people will be just coming down and sticking their snouts right in the trough, right in the Olympic Games venue itself as the announcement comes over. So it'll be just bums in the air, snouts in the trough, as Juan says that magic word.
Sydney.
Beautifully put.
Yeah.
And I hope he's got a special pronunciation of it, like Atlanta. Who can forget that?
Sydney.
Or Sydney.
Sydney.
Do you know what I mean? Something with a twist.
Something wrong.
That's Juan.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, large crowds are expected, including a problem, obviously, in the area of Circular Quay and Darling Harbour on the night. And 8,000 invited guests will be, whooping it up inside the Opera House. Then if we win, everybody can come out and celebrate conga line past the table of jats growing with King Wally Lewis cheese style. And so it's going to be all thrown on. Now, there'll be giant screens up at various points, fireworks, obviously, laser show, obviously. I know Dame Tirithi Tukano is coming over to sing with the SSO. Jeff Kennett's coming up, bringing one of his musicals up to Sydney to put on there. And they've bought about 50,000 flags. They're going to decorate the city and so on. But, Roy, you've been roped in for a lot of the work. How's it going for the big night?
Oh, look, I think it's going well. I want it to be memorable. We'll be locking off all of the inner city with gates, so that people have to...
Bicentennial style, if people can remember that.
If people want to go through, they've got to drink copious amounts of beer. There'll be yards of beer free on offer, and you queue up and you have, say, beer fest style, two or three we haven't decided yet. I'm plumping for 8 yards of beer to be consumed by people before they walk in to the city, where we'll have beer flowing everywhere, wine flowing everywhere. As you mentioned, every corner will have a stall upon which will be jats and all sorts of date recipes. People are just encouraged to gorge themselves as much as they possibly can. To make it something memorable. It's going to be Carnivale style, and obviously, if people wish to partake nude, they will be certainly encouraged to. All police officers who will be volunteering their services for the assistance of the handing out of the beer will be nude, and as a sort of special bicentennial gesture, Freudian slip there, as a Sydney 2000 gesture, the salute will be the toggling of a police person's wedding tackle. That is the symbol for the games. So any police person who is seen, all you've got to do is walk up to him, if it's a male, obviously, and just give a little flip, flip, flip of the gear. And I think that's a really interesting and beautiful salute, which symbolises, I think, Sydney's bid for the Sydney for the Olympics in the year 2000. I want something absolutely memorable. And I think a lot of nudists drunk.
Would be the perfect way to put it off. But I'd go further than that, Roy. I think your idea of having your breath analysers on the way in, you know, and you blow in.
Oh, yeah. If you're not over 0.08, you can't
out.
Get in.
Yeah, that's right. You just got to go back to the table in the yard. Yeah. And also, the people arriving in Lederhosen.
Free entry.
Free entry. That's right. Yeah. Just Lederhosen alone.
If it's gustless.
Gustless, so the toggle can go on.
Yeah.
Yes. And I think that's got Australia, it's got Asia, it's got Olympics.
It's a little bit different.
Written all over it. It's a tremendous idea. And how are these ideas being received by a person who loved to party, say, Brucey Baird?
Well, Brucey Baird's over the moon. Brucey was a bit down on the idea until I mentioned the word toggle and nude. And once those two words were received by his ears in tandem, he thought it was, quote, an electric idea. And he had to sit down at the very thought of it. Bruce is, you know how Bruce is transported by nudity.
And he loves to dress up.
And he loves to dress down.
Roy. Bruce, this week in rugby league, of course, is the sensational news that the Moroccans are on board.
Ah, yes.
The Moroccans, obviously, the MRLFC have been a very big powerhouse for the league in Africa. And now that Asia's cracked and tumbled, you only have to look at the Kumuls to realise that and realise that Indonesia and the Seychelles are soon to fall in line, that Africa is the great untapped resource when it comes to league. And now that the Moroccans are interested, I understand, the game has been nurtured in Morocco by Great Britain, although that's not a tremendous rap in itself, but Morocco have sent an application to be part of the Quit for Life Sevens. They will not be intimidated by their big-name rivals. And the last line of their letter that we saw this week is, Morocco is ready for Sydney Rugby League, but is Sydney Rugby League ready for Morocco? Very, very, what would you call it, provocative words?
Provocative words, yes. Because the standard's very high.
I was going to say, you know the Moroccan Rugby League story better than most.
I do. Look, it's tremendous. Moroccan Rugby, the first time I went to Morocco, I just played a pickup game. And I was amazed at the skills they've got there. Amazed. And, I put down a very, very, what I thought to be a very shallow route of rugby league, in as much as I left a ball there and a guernsey and a pair of boots and a pair of shorts. I said, I've given you the rules. You've got the gear there to go on with. All the best. And I hadn't been back. And to think that 20 or so years down the track, that they're challenging to come to Australia, wanting, up and willing, because they're marvellous people, your Moroccans. Sure, they've had rough times over the years. You know, British have given them a rough time. They get a rough time from Arabs from time to time. But they are tremendous people. Tremendous people. And I know if they do commit themselves to rugby league will be much the better for it. They are tremendous people, and I'm looking forward to them coming out here. But it's not only Morocco. See, if Morocco falls to league, then
Sudan.
Cameroon.
Oh, Cameroon's on without a doubt.
Will fall to league.
Yes.
Then it's not a great leap to see Persia fall to league. And by Persia, I mean your Iraq, your Iran, those areas. I know Colonel Gaddafi, for example.
In Libya.
Loves his league.
Mad North Sydney supporter,
They are. I mean, if you're ever in a tent with Gaddafi and things are going a little bit awry, i.e., you know how moody he gets? He gets very, very moody, and he might start filling with an AK-15 or an AK-17 and, banging off a few things. I, having been in that circumstances once, I through an interpreter, said to, could you pass on to the colonel the fact that I love rugby league? And he put the gun down. He looked at me. He smiled. You could see tears welling in the corner. He called me a brother in very halting English. We did a big cuddle. We nibbled each other's ear. And we sat down and we just looked at each other with admiration there for half an hour before, you know, we upped stumps and I left. But he loves his league. And I think if we can get someone like Gaddafi on board, with Morocco on board, Cameroon falling into play, as you say, Sudan, then you go. It's not
Egypt.
You don't get down the Nile, across the Suez, across the Negev desert.
And I put it to you, Lloyd, that the only reason why the United Nations isn't the greatest advocate for rugby league is no one's asked them.
Yes. Which was Harley.
Is the greatest 5/8.
Yes, that the United Nations has ever seen.
Yeah, that's right. And the bloke before him, that goes back a couple of months, I forget who took over, but he was the best ball-playing pop of a generation, internationally speaking.
Yes.
I'd love to see, all the United Nations get on board the league train. And as I've said elsewhere in media commitments this week, the development of the game in Russia has founded upon largely a lot of people being locked up behind bars, the problem of people living in gutters and not having homes.
Yes.
I
just don't have access to Guernseys, shorts, studded boots, and student balls. They just don't have access to that. Sure, you can use your imagination, but nothing. I mean, you've got to actually have a hand. You've got to have a ball for it to begin with to have a game of football. And if you're denied that, then you just can't imagine. You can't see rugby league spontaneously combusting, spontaneously kicking off. In an area where, sure, you've got the people, sure, you've got the willingness, sure, you've got the imagination, but you just haven't got the ball.
And there's only so much you can do with an old, South Sydney footy sock with a lot of holes in it, filled up with paper.
Or an old pig's head.
Yeah.
Fly-blown
pig's head. It's hard to pick it up, tuck it under your arm and run.
Well it's unattractive.
Yeah.
You don't want to feel it. The ball comes to you. You hope it's a cutout pass.
My great...
Now on This Sporting Life, a man who has done all the work this week and emerged a winner. He's a man who comes into his own in the hard-fought final series, a bloke who loves the firmer going of September. He rises to this next question like a big brown trout in a mountain stream, leaping clear of the ooze for a beautifully tied horsehair fly. You can see him out there lurking under a big log, just a streak of brown, and it will require all your skill to get him up and on the tug. Let's get him out of the water and biting simply by asking, as we cast our line in his direction, rampaging Roy Slaven, how'd you see the week's sun?
How reliable is your man in the preventative stakes? If he's anything like my Leon, his track record is pretty poor. But all this has changed thanks to recent developments at the Nelson Slaven Medical Research Laboratories. The boffins down at the labs have developed the first double-sided, totally reversible, ecologically sound edible condom in your favourite club colours. Roy says it's a moral for safety and a dead-set shoo-in for getting over the contraception hurdle. Welcome the big boy in next time he comes knocking with a condom that's the short-priced favourite with the smart money set. Gee, I wish they had them when I was a nipper. As for Leon, he just can't get enough time trackside these days.
When you look at this 1994 calendar, Roy, obviously you've got Ricky Stewart in the Casablanca look. You've got Steve Renouf with a big dead fish. You've got Scotty Mann, Scotty Mann looking tremendous. I can't put it any other way. Mark Coyne, in your Wild West gear with your sheepskin vest and your big length of rope alongside him, signifying something in the pants. Nigel Gaffrey, just pure sex. David Fairley with a big horse and a vest, looking very, very good. Ricky Stewart inside, just nude to the nude. Johnny Cross, Sean Hobby, etc. On and on it goes. Yes. It is tremendous work. A lot of it shot, I understand, on the Gold Coast, Movie World and Sea World.
Well, yes, I suppose it is. It's the Warner Brothers world there. Which is very... it's showbiz.
Yeah.
It's like, you might as well be in L.A. It reminds me very much of L.A. and all the, accoutrements that go with L.A., i.e., hopeless, really. But Ricky Stewart... Wasn't Ricky Stewart in last year's...
I think he has been a couple.
Yeah. Yes, but wasn't he in the Casablanca look last year?
Now that you call, I think he
Why
was.
Why is he going with the Casablanca look again?
Well...
Why couldn't we see a new aspect of Ricky?
Like,
Ricky just bent over
with a mic.
Well, if you like, just a mic coming out at you, and you don't know who it is. It's just a set of bare buttocks underneath written Ricky Stewart. Well,
I think that'll happen. That's your abstract. That's your abstract.
Well, that's your Max Dupayne.
That's right. That's Maxie Dupayne work.
Yeah.
I think that Maxie will be on board for the next one because I think
Maxie still with us.
I'd love to think that he's still with us.
Max would do with Ricky Stewart, bent over in a microphone.
Well, and
shade-wise, I mean, your shadows, Max was all about shadows.
the space between. What I was going to say, Roy, is once you get some of these senior people into it, I think that your coaches and your commentators, then you do need, you have to raise the threshold of art on the other side to accommodate them. Obviously, if you had Artie Beetson with the white front around the ankles. On the job, in inverted commas, with, say, a Bomber Peard, you'd need to have a very, very tasteful...
On the job with Bomber Peard? What do you mean on the job? You mean...
I said that in inverted commas.
Involved?
Certainly involved in the same space-time relationship, but, in inverted commas...
Spoon-style?
It's all in the eye of the beholder.
Oh.
Nothing going on between
Max
artists.
Just suggested.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I meant. Maxie would suggest this.
Right. With a shadow.
You take me far too literally, Roy.
Sorry.
Here. I mean, I'm suggesting art.
Yes.
Art is the artifice of suggesting a lot more than...
No.
Well, obviously, when you look at this year's calendar, you can't.
But if you have a couple of old footballers in a photo...
old footballers!
Yes, enables your imagination to run wild.
Well, I think old footballers is the way to go.
Bar Lamb. Bar's still with us.
Yeah, when he retires. Say, 10 years on.
Yes,
he's let down.
Bar Lamb and Dale Shearer. Just to pluck two out of the air.
Oh, that'd be tremendous. So, players who were going around about 10 years ago.
Yeah. Who have Chris Close.
How about Bruce Clark?
And Chris Close.
And Chris Close for Mr. January.
Yeah.
Well, that's got something written all over it. How about Kerry Hemsley, the Brigadier?
There's nothing separating them.
Except a footy.
Except a shady
blur.
Something like that. What do you think?
Yeah, well, that's tremendous. Or, say, I was thinking of, say, Kerry Hemsley and a camel.
Oh, your animals sort of...
Yeah, well, there's a few animals in this current calendar. I'm just taking that up as a theme.
Yeah.
Obviously, Steve Renouf's got a dead fish, and, there's a horse with David Fairley in the current gear. Now, I think that, a camel and Kerry Hemsley could look tremendously exciting. Tremendously exciting.
One hump or two.
Well, I'm happy for Max.
Sort of dramatry?
Well, I'm happy for Max to fill in the edges.
Oh, Max,
yeah, Maxie
the
Dupin.
I'm just
doing a bit of casting here.
Yes.
And I'd love to see Mick Pobgey. I don't know whether Mick's still around, but Mick Pobgey and
an elephant.
I was thinking more of an Alsatian dog with Mick. Older players, is Ross Conlon still available for this sort of work?
Of course you would. Ross Conlon, the stick insects. I mean, why not? Open it up.
Yeah, we're too far,
We're too limited.
Who knows?
We aren't photographers, we aren't artists. I mean, we're just a couple of blokes.
I tell you this.
Running ideas up a flagpole, and the flagpole is...
Very big.
Yes.
Yeah. I was going to say, who's to say that Stig Insects and Ross Conlon wouldn't make a calendar move quicker than having Ricky Stewart in the Casablanca look?
Well,
who is to know? There's only one way to find out.
Well, the market.
I know.
Let the market determine these things.
Yeah. Put it out there and see who salutes it.
That's right. I know, an octopus and a couple of squid rings.
On the end of a flute.
On the end of a flute.
That's attached to... Well, somebody retired 10 years ago. Now, I'll have to think about this.
Craig Young.
Or Tommy Radonikis. Craig Young. Yes, Craig Young.
Tommy would be probably a little bit shy about doing that sort of...
Tommy Radonikis would... Would Tommy be bashful about coming forward for a rugby league calendar?
Well, that's sort of Max Dupain one, yes.
Well,
given the operation, he... Why not?
It's got to be there. It's part of life.
It's part of life.
Even if you want to sweep it under the carpet, it doesn't prevent from being a big bump in the carpet when you push all the poo underneath there.
Kevin Hardwick.
Yeah.
And a letterbox.
Yeah. That's right. Well, what I'd love to see is, now you got me thinking about the stick insects, though. I can't get it out of my mind. One on the top of the flute and one underneath.
Well, it's a stick insect sandwich.
Well, with a flute in the middle.
Well, that's got winner written all over it. Don't tell me these ideas won't be up and running either.
No,
in a couple of years'
time,
it will be. Just food, of course, as an ingredient that could be incorporated with the players in the shots. Food.
Well, I thought we gave it, you're suggesting calamari.
Oh, we did
octopus.
Mention calamari and octopus,
but, food like... like a beautiful whipped cream and, that sort of thing, like suggestive food or just ordinary food, like a stick of celery.
Well, a fruit salad. Let's say players' legs akimbo, back doors facing you.
What, with a can of Golden Circle fruit salad dribbling out of the date?
Yes, fruit salads. Fruit salads emerging.
In black and white?
Could be. Or only care the player in black and white and the fruit salad in colour. Imagine that sort of interesting juxtaposition.
Now, surely, obviously, a lot of players would like to choose, let's say...
nominate their own fruit.
But would you let them have a cream
Remington? No, I mean, if Ricky Stewart said, I'll only be photographed with pears, a tin of pears, Well, you'd have to say, well, thanks very much, Mr. Stewart. We'll use someone else.
Yeah, I mean, if Phil Blake only wanted a banana.
Yeah, well.
You know, you'd have to
Well, you'd try it.
Yeah, you'd see how far you get.
Yeah,
show us what you want to do.
What have you got in mind?
Yeah, with banana.
Yeah.
But surely the bits of food should somehow add to the allure of...
Of course it should. Sucks like a Dura cream wafers.
Yes. That's beautifully put. Yes. Yes. A beautiful...
can of condensed milk?
Yeah, I was thinking of the yoghurt down the trousers 9.5 weeks style. But what I meant was, you know, say...
Well, you're assuming there are trousers there.
Yes.
Imagine without the trousers.
Yes, of course. It's just the can of yoghurt.
Just the can, yes.
Yeah.
Just the condensed milk, you know, doing its thing, man.
I was thinking more of a pawpaw.
Oh, yeah.
You know, work with a pawpaw.
Well, that is the fruit of sex, your pawpaw.
Yeah. Well, obviously, it's a pawpaw rugby league calendar.
Mm.
Mm. Well, I'm glad, though, that somebody did mention food. We'd only have to work on it for another 30 seconds. We would have got food into it. As nearly as I can tell, the iconography here is aeroplanes,
yeah.
Wild West, movie sets, yeah. Dead fish.
Electric saws and hammers,
a Black and Decker workmate.
Yes.
Or, you know, a flute and a vice.
Yes.
You know, there's your S&M.
You know, in the garage.
One more turn.
Well, with someone with, say, Artie Beetson winding the vice in on Ricky Stewart.
Yeah.
Or get them back together, the old squirrel gripper. Get Marty Bella
doing the vice
doing
work.
The vice work
on Ricky Stewart.
Ricky Stewart.
Now you're talking.
Now it's something that's emerged.
Yeah.
From reality. Yeah. He's saying something.
If you say a lot about league and people, and if we can't find a photographer prepared to do it, you and I.
I'd do it.
Yeah, I know.
Of course we would.
I'd like the gear for you.
We have some other ideas. You know, the gouger. Get back gougers.
Yeah, well, that'd be tremendous.
Or biters.
Yeah, could we do something with the parrot?
There was some blue ribbon biters.
Well, there was
Rocket Ready, I think, was a biter, wouldn't he?
Well, if not, why not create the myth that Rocket was a biter?
All right, Rocket biting someone down below. In the garage.
With the Black and Deck. Yeah. While they're working on a boat or something big. You know what I mean? That would be a tremendous snap. With the stick insects walking along.
That's right.
And
yes.
The fruit.
Yes.
And the cream.
Yes.
And the condensed milk.
And the condensed milk just
dripping all over.
Yeah. That's right. Or focus on the lens.
Vaseline. Look. Yeah. Mm. Well, I think there's too many ideas there, really. Why is the calendar this year so boring in relation to
that? It's the dumbest bit of crap I've ever seen in my life.
Hey Pillows, feeling slim-hipped and lonely? Looking for a date? Your last partner pouted when the candle went out? Then be lonely no longer. The Elvis Society, run exclusively for your happiness by Roy Slaven and H.G. Nelson, can match your emotional profile with that of major international sporting identities. Once the battery is thrown in the beast and the connections are pushed into place, it's up to the pair of you to turn the motor over, hop in the back seat and hang on for the ride. Remember, friends, when you ring, at the end of the 008 This Sporting Lifeline is another pillow, just as lonely as you. As Elvis used to say, love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. Oh, my darling, I love you, and I always will. The King Tide Sleepmaker is so successful, you can't wait.